the 737 MAX are back in the sky.
Hi, good morning.
First time on the MAX 9 after 2 years.
Well, there's my control. If we can't control the trim on the airplane, then it's a simple fix. So
we test all the systems in the airplane.
MCAS system test, okay.
I'd put my family in the back of the plane. I mean, that's kind of the bottom line.
To American Maintenance Center at Tulsa.
We're really built around a chain of safety. And when the chain of safety breaks, it's up to those of us in the industry to mend it and bring it back.
How long it's taking actually each MAX to be recertified, the rework to be done here.
The interesting backstory there was there was a project called Project Apollo 11. So when Airbus announced the A320neo series, and then they went to Boeing and they said, what aircraft do you have?
Time will tell. MAX has a long way to prove itself.
The 737 MAX are back in the sky. I recently flew on United MAX 9 and American MAX 8. Let's check out these flights. I also spoke to the pilot flying them.
Miami, Houston today on the 737 MAX 9. First time on the MAX 9 after 2 years.
The MAX, I think, is the, gosh, it's, technologically, it's a fabulous airplane. And I think most pilots enjoy flying it. I know the company enjoys it because it sips fuel. So yeah, I mean, it's the most scrutinized plane ever. And they did make some changes, and you know, we went through some additional training, but I'd put my family in the back of the plane. I mean, that's kind of the bottom line. I've always told my kids and my wife, hey, I'm coming home. And I will never take an airplane that I'm not comfortable getting on. And I certainly look at a passenger as, if I'm comfortable with my family flying, then I'm comfortable for someone else flying in the back. And that's what it boils down to me. My name is Russ. This is Corey. We're flying Miami to Houston today, flight 704. We have 2 hours and 31 minutes of flying.
How high can a MAX go up to?
41,000.
41,000.
Today we're actually flying at scheduled at 30,000. Because the turbulence is above 30,000, so we're gonna take a lower altitude, burn more gas, but it's better comfort-wise for passengers, well, and for us to fly at a lower altitude. The biggest change and upgrade for us is the size of the screens. So for us older people that are vision, you know, it's great graphics, and you can change the graphics up. Here's our control panel for the instruments. And then we can switch this back and forth. For example, today I'm flying the aircraft to Houston, so I'll put all the instruments, the engine instruments, on my side. So that gives you your engine speeds, your temperatures, your fuel flow, your oil pressure, oil quantity, all these things, flap settings. So that puts it right in direct line with me as the flying pilot. Some people can switch it back and forth. Just bigger displays, quieter cockpit. We have the control panels are different. Basically, the engine fuel controls are a little bit different. These are the standard emergency cutoff switches. You know, the big talk was about the MCAS. Well, there's my control. If we can't control the trim on the airplane, then it's a simple fix. There's our controls for the runaway trim stuff. So,
yeah, the MAX is a great airplane. It flies really, really well. And we test this system every morning whenever we get in the airplane.
Terrain, get scared. Up.
This is a test,
obstacle,
right?
Obstacle.
Yeah, testing
it. Up. Runway awareness. Okay.
It's the first flight of the day for this airplane.
Airspeed low.
We test all the systems in the airplane.
But MCAS system test. Okay.
They have automated a lot of systems in it.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good morning.
Mask one over our nose and mouth, please. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Good morning.
Hi, good morning.
Just about ready to push out the gate for departure. 2 hours and 31 minutes of flying today. It's very windy in Miami today. We're expecting a little bit of a bumpy ride on the climb out. We've asked the flight attendants to stay seated for departure or after departure, and we do ask that you do please remain seated with your seatbelt fastened.
about my third flight on the 737 MAX. Our bins here are much larger that can hold more suitcases and in a upright manner instead of laying flat. Our galleys here are the same pretty much configurations as other 737s. In the terms of everything coming back, we have our hot and our cold beverages, sodas. We have our beer and wine and minis, and we have individual waters to hand out to our passengers. Along with our sandwiches of 2.5 hours or more, we have a vegetarian sandwich and a chicken sandwich. Select snack box for you.
Standard first class seats. It does have a little good recline and it slides forward, so when you recline, it's actually a little bit better. And the armrest can go up, so there's a little bit extra room on the armrest. I just don't see any difference. I couldn't feel any difference flying on the MAX before the grounding and after reactivated. Time will tell. MAX has a long way to prove itself.
My American Airlines MAX flight was a very short one from Orlando to Miami. In fact, the night before, I have to turn down an opportunity to fly on a Falcon 900 private jets in order to fly on the MAX next morning. I think I'm a little crazy. The interior American Airlines MAX was underwhelming. The first class has very limited seat pitch. There was no PTV. The whole cabin looks a little bit plasticky and has this gray color feeling. Economy class at the back has very limited legroom, comparable to a low-cost airline. There was no food, no drink, no service, just sit down the whole way from Orlando to Miami. It was only a 40 minutes flight. However, the scenery en route was beautiful though. I really enjoyed the takeoff, and then we flew over South Florida, see the beaches and stretch, and also flew over Fort Lauderdale International before we turned over to Miami for the landing. It was a very uneventful flight, but it was a very smooth flight. So during my stay in Miami, I met an aviation journalist, Chris Sloan, who flew on the first MAX in the US after 20 minutes of grounding to American Maintenance Center at Tulsa.
We flew a day trip from the Dallas-Fort Worth Airport to Tulsa, which is the location of American Airlines, what's called the M&E base, Maintenance and Engineering. And that base also happens to be the largest private airline maintenance base in the world. And it's where the MAX essentially was undergoing conversions with the new MCAS software being installed, the wiring harness corrections being made, and a number of the FAA's directives being satisfied. That was all happening in Tulsa.
Welcome aboard. This is Captain Peter Gamble. I'll be taking you up to Tulsa and you're back today. A little discussion on the history of aviation. I mean, it's a really built around a chain of safety. And when the chain of safety breaks, it's up to those of us in the industry to mend it and bring it back. There's been many, many hours of men and women in the industry that have spent 20 months of making sure that the chain that was broken that resulted in some accidents has been mended. And going forward, we make that chain stronger and stronger. So Doug Parker mentioned from the beginning that this aircraft will be safe to fly when the pilots see it safe. We're here to make sure that that is the case today.
So we all boarded. We flew 45 minutes through a pretty miserable flight just because of the weather conditions. And we were going to be taken to the maintenance base, and we were really given a pretty much all-access pass to really see what American was doing to create this level of comfort. The chief commercial officer, David Seymour, told us, he said, you know, I asked him, I said, so why are you guys in such a hurry to take a leadership position in returning the MAX to service? American had 24 of them at the time of grounding, Southwest had 35. American decided to return the service plane to service earlier by a number of months than either United or Southwest. And he said, you know, we're not going to rebuild confidence in an airplane unless it's flying. It's not going to rebuild any confidence just by sitting on the ground. So they felt it very important to proactively get out there and meet the issue head on and show everybody why they're absolutely confident that the MAX was ready to return to service.
So we have a program development team among our instructors, and they took all that information and they built simulations for all those items. So they actually go out and they do what's called a stall series. So they bring the airplane up to where it doesn't fly, and that's where the MCAS will start to activate. So they get to see that and they get to recover from it. So they get to see it operate so that they understand what the noises and the cockpit indications that are going on. Then we do a runaway stabilizer trim where it runs away and they have to react to that. We have recall items which have to be committed from memory. And they do that procedure, they come back around and land. They're required to go around in the landing so they are before they land. So it's not always successful. So they get to see how to deal with those things and manual trimming as they're doing a go around. And then also the high angle of attack, which was a failure of the angle of attack vane. One was installed incorrectly, they believe the other one was damaged on the takeoff. Creates an unreliable airspeed, so one side of the cockpit is not indicating correctly. So there are memory items, recall items that they have to perform there.
What they do is if they see a difference between the two angles of attack more than 5.5 degrees or more, then they'll shut off MCAS for the duration of the flight. They also have another layer that's for if they have high angle of attack is sensed, that it'll only allow MCAS to activate one time. So MCAS is actually something that is used if there's a highway event, like a stall event or something, or approach to stall, where MCAS would activate normally. So if it is, if there were a situation where it would be activating, it only activates at one time.
I was curious how long it's taking actually each MAX to be recertified, the rework to be done here.
The software upgrade itself for the MCAS system takes approximately 6 hours to start spinning. The reactivation out of storage takes about 8 to 10 days.
Per aircraft?
Per aircraft.
And the rewiring work, is that being done by you all
as
well?
That's being done during that time frame, yes.
So in 6 to 8 days?
Right.
This is going to be the beginning of a long journey. It's been a 20-month journey, but really it's just the beginning of yet another one. It's going to take 2 years to return all these MAXs to the skies. The attention to maintenance and operations is going to have to be meticulous, because even though the aircraft's been heavily scrutinized, the most scrutinized aircraft in history, you know, every little incident, every little problem will, you know, raise eyebrows and be heavily scrutinized itself.
The significance of the MAX was American was really the first airline to order the MAX, and back in 2011 it was 200 737 MAXs and 260 A321s, 319, 320s, and that was the largest up until that point aircraft order in history for commercial airliner. The interesting backstory there was a project called Project Apollo 11, and there was a battle going between Boeing and Airbus to see who would net this order for 460 aircraft. So when Airbus announced the A320neo series, there really wasn't an answer to that on the Boeing side. So American purchased 260 neo aircraft in the 319 and 321s. And they went to Boeing and they said, what aircraft do you have that has this kind of efficiency that, say, the neo does? At the same time, Boeing was developing a replacement for the 737. It was called Project Yellowstone. It was going to be a completely new generation NSA, new small aircraft. And so what ended up happening was, you know, American didn't want to wait, and nor did Southwest. So they basically forced Boeing to build the MAX. And that's when American placed an order for 200 of those in 2011, and the first entered series, the first MAX entered service in 2017.
I agree that you won't be able to rebuild that confidence when the airplane is grounded. The airplane has to fly to prove its safety. I won't persuade you to fly on a MAX. I just want to share with you my two MAX flight experiences and what happened behind the scenes at American Airlines Maintenance Center. Time will tell. I think the MAX has to prove itself over time. Thanks for watching.